What is up, YouTube? It's currently 6:50 in the morning and I'm on my way. I thought it was gonna be pretty cool, so that's why I wanted to share with you guys. Today I'm going to go to an event where one of the keynote speakers is Steve Wozniak, aka the Woz. If you don't know who the Woz is, stop this video, give it a quick Google, and you'll see why it's a big deal. Steve Woz is one of two very important Steves, and the other Steve is Steve Jobs. These are the two guys that co-founded Apple, along with a third member, doesn't get mentioned a lot. He was basically like the brains of the operations when it came to like the mechanic and the actual products of Apple in the early years. And you know, Jobs was the businessman who built the company. Woz built the products. I'm a big fan of Jobs. I'm a big fan of Apple. And as a connection, I'm a fan of Woz. Can't say I'm a big fan. I don't know too much about him, but I know just enough to admire him on a whole different level. I'm really excited for today, and I hope we get to hear some interesting takes. I hope he talks about like future industries and his opinion and views on the current world and just things of that nature. Hopefully I'll get some of it on camera and we'll see how it goes. All right, so I'm at a stop and I figured I'd fill you guys in on what the event is exactly and why it's semi a big deal. The event is held by eMerge Americas. I don't know if you guys be able to see that. Basically, it's going to be various speakers across industries who are either leaders or impactful people in their respective industries. We actually have several CEOs on this agenda. Event is for 2 days. I don't know if I'll go to second day. We'll see. This is just a quick breakdown on what's going on Monday. We have Steve Wozniak. After that, we have the CEO of Sprint doing a keynote. You know, different subject or topics at hand. We got options here, bro. We got options. To close out today's event, Pitbull. I mean, it is Miami. He is a groundbreaking artist in several ways. The biggest way, him being such a prominent Latino Americano artist who's been pushing the Hispanic culture for a while now. The event goes on from 9 in the morning to 6 p.m. I don't think I'm gonna make it to 6 p.m. I'll probably leave around lunch. I just want to see the people I want to see, gain some knowledge, gain some insight, maybe talk to a few people, and then get the fuck out.
Alright, so we're at the site. If you're wondering why I'm wearing a hoodie, is because it's Miami and it's rainy, because that's how it is 99% of the summer. Don't get it twisted.
Hey Jim!
Woz, I'm gonna see you on the
block. For they hood, they city. I'm trying to make music for the world, you feel me, right, B.O.B.? So, this is what we came up with.
That's the level I'm trying to get at. Yeah, the stabilization on that, the smoothness that they're about to get, 100.
I got up today, and my flight was late, on my way to L.A. I jumped up on a plane.
Alright, all this cool shit we can check out later. First things first, we're gonna go to the Woz keynote stage because, I mean, that's the main reason I'm here. I tweeted him, told him, yo, let's get coffee. Maybe he'll respond, you never know. Nah, he won't, he won't.
Put on my shade and threw on my headphones. I was vibing to this beat. It made me move my feet. But that thing was sticky.
Good morning, everybody.
What a great honor to have you here again. Can you believe it? The fourth year? Doesn't it seem like yesterday that this whole thing started as a little dream of creating this incredible platform where people from Europe, Latin America, North America, now the whole world come together to exchange ideas, show their innovation, and come forth with what is happening in the world of technology today.
Next year, this is going to be the most high-tech, incredible convention center. We're spending $600 million because we are truly becoming a high-tech innovation capital. You know, we have some great high-tech things. You know, we have NASA, which we call the Silicon Valley of Florida. And of course, our universities are growing. And one thing I'll tell you, South Florida has a lot of available capital. So with these great ideas, you're going to find a lot of funding down in Miami, a lot of people from all over the world. We call ourselves the capital of South America.
I guess I'll start now. The state of technology has become so important to us, how it changes our lives. A lot of that I even take back to Apple Computer and Steve Jobs, and he grew up as a non-technician. He didn't understand the insides of computers well. He couldn't create the insides himself, but he understood people and what people wanted. And he was always trying to build computers for himself. for somebody that he understood. And he failed and failed and failed because the early days of computers, computers was those people that knew how to follow engineering steps and make things that actually worked. And Steve wasn't one of those. He was somebody that just had a life and wanted to get to a point where the things a normal person does in life make sense and the technology doesn't matter. You don't want to have megahertz and interrupt pins on microprocessors. You don't want all these technical jargon and words and meaning because it was out of his understanding. To get to today, there were a lot of steps. Every step, personal computer said a computer is not a big, you know, faceplate with all these switches and little nomenclature that nobody can understand except the expert who has been trained to run it. And then we moved towards a human keyboard. It looks like a typewriter. A keyboard and a video display was the only cheap output device. If you owned a television, a video display was free. Input-output was the most expensive part that was keeping us from getting to affordable computers for a long time. So we made life easy and more human, the way humans were used to. I can type things and I can see it on a screen and I can actually run programs too. And that was a start. Now we took a step at a later year. I mean, eventually you could plug in a lot of accessories. Our Apple II was a totally open project, the opposite of an Apple you hear about today. Totally open, we distributed our designs, our schematics, they're mine really, and all of our code, all my code, and everybody could analyze it and say, oh my gosh, I sort of understand how these computers work. I see how you write programs. They could say, this is what I want to do for my life. So a lot of people at a young age, their parents bought them an Apple II computer and they wind up being CEOs of companies. Now the Apple II computer was a very special product. It wasn't just one attempt to help start Apple Computer. The Apple II, I had designed games for Atari. The arcade industry was starting. It's going to become a huge industry. And the arcade games were all black and white for cost reasons and technology reasons. It was hard to do color. And they were all hardware designs. Hardware means you solder wires on chips to get signals to go at the right timing. And it's so difficult. You could have a simple arcade game that took 100 chips or 150 chips, huge designs. I hate that. I only like things very small. Well, the Apple II computer was the first time that arcade games would be color. I had this dream of how beautiful games would be in color. And then instead of a $5,000 device to create color, I thought of a way to do it for $0. It's weird, but instead of putting a number into an electronic device that I knew how to design with differential calculus and everything that would put a color signal on a TV, I realized that the number itself in memory, if you put it on a wire into the TV, it turned into color. Don't ask me how I came up with that idea. I still don't know. I do know that I was doing a job for Atari and I was 4 days and nights without sleep, and your head kind of wanders into creative space. So, the Apple II was the first time ever arcade games would be color. More importantly, the first time ever arcade games would be software instead of hardware. Meaning a 9-year-old kid could write a program saying vertical equals 1, vertical equals 2, vertical equals 3, and make things move on a screen. It was that easy to make things move on a screen for a normal person, not an engineer. So this was a huge step. That product was going to be big and so far ahead of the rest of the world. We wouldn't have to continually raise round after round after round of funding either. And Apple had two starts. We started once with the Apple I. It's kind of called the garage days, although we never had a company in a garage. The garage represents the fact you have to work at home when you have no money. Steve Jobs and myself had no savings accounts. We're in our young 20s. We have no business experience. So that was the Apple I days, and we started with three people. Steve and I and Ron Wayne had 10%, but Ron sold his out after a few weeks for some hundreds of dollars.
See, I want to interrupt you for one.
Well, I think we're going to move on to a different part of the program.
Want to know about Apple today. What's your opinion of the company today? It's getting the rap of not being innovative enough.
Well,
not being
the larger anything enough. Is, think about physics. If you have a small little marble, it's easy to push it. You've got a big heavy car, push and it barely moves. The larger something is, the slower it tends to move. And also, in our early days of Apple, since I did all of the design and the technology work and the software and the hardware and the fixing and the testing and every little bit of it myself, I never had to rely on committees doing individual parts of it. So there's a lot of things that slow slow big companies down into taking the next step and all that. And sometimes people think, oh, it's not innovative. They're coming out with a whole new class of product. And I very much disagree. Yeah, Apple today, it was the first company to put Touch ID on. I mean, I love that Touch ID to identify myself instead of having to memorize passwords all the time, especially on my computer. You got Touch ID now on your MacBook Pro, but every other company that makes smartphones followed Apple's lead. Look who the leader is. You know, they followed. This was an important thing that would change a lot of how we do things in our life in a significant way. It wasn't just a fun, fancy feature. It wasn't just a little better camera. People say, oh, I have this phone because it has a better camera. No, your choice to pick a phone has nothing to do with camera. They're all so good now.
All right, I think we have a question from the audience. Did we get a mic runner, get a mic out?
Steve, what are your views of personal privacy in the future?
Personal privacy, I'm a strong advocate of personal privacy because all my life I've dealt with thinking about the human versus technology. Who's more important? Apple stood out very much for making things easy, understandable, intuitive, took very many approaches towards the humanness, and a human should even have private areas. My little secrets should be mine. Things that I want to whisper to my wife should be private, and I'm one of the founders of the EFF. So that should answer the question. I was brought up with the very constitutional instruction that I bought into. And one of them, the Fourth Amendment, your home is your home. And it cannot be entered and invaded and searched without the proper documents and a warrant. And they're saying, well, my home is where I put my private stuff. Well, now it's all in our computers. So why can they search that? I recently pulled out of an event for the first time in my life. Called up, you know, the week it was coming up because it was in Turkey. And I'd have to check my laptop on the way back home out of my sight. You know, and so I don't like that. Cybersecurity, there are so many ways into our computers nowadays with the internet and the operating systems that are designed for access from the right people from afar, while the wrong people figure out how to get in as the right people. I mean, my Raspberry Pi that lets me see Google from China, okay, because you have to encrypt it and hide the fact you're getting to Google or Facebook to get it from China. So I use a little Raspberry Pi at home, and then I use a $9 chip computer because I like the cheaper solution over the expensive one. But I make sure that it won't even, I saw them probing it and trying to guess the root password. Oh my God, this is horrible. So I set mine up so there's no root password even. You don't even have a password. You cannot get into it with a password. It's just encryption code to encryption code.
Wow.
But anyway, I'm a strong advocate for privacy, and it's been overrun to where anything you've got, we can peek into governments of our own and of others. We can peek into your stuff, and we have the right to do it, and we're going to make it legal for us to do it. I don't like that. I think it's unconstitutional.
We just got out of the WAS stage. It was pretty good talk. I think it was much more intriguing when he was speaking by himself and he was speaking about the origins of Apple and the origins of like tech. And after that, it got more into like the current futuristic view on what could happen. You guys will see. And now I'm out here gonna check out different booths. I don't expect to see anything mind-blowing like crazy, but I'll try my best to show you guys what is popping over here.
And then I heard this, the dopest one I've ever seen. Something out the usual. Mr. Pilot, please. I think I got a hit on
every South Florida rapper, any rapper out there on SoundCloud, YouTube. So what you just guys saw called Recordgram. It's not gonna focus right now. It's pretty cool. It's basically like Musical.ly on steroids. You guys should definitely check it out. So far, that's the first thing that's caught my attention big time, because it's a balance of social and tech. Basically, for anyone who's trying to become an artist, up and coming producer or vocal artist, a singer or a rapper, you basically can use it as a platform, and you can use beats for free from major producers to do covers or independent beats that you find from other producers that put it on for free. You could also lease it if they decide to charge you for it, but it's less than $5, they said. From there, you can shoot a video, you can record a song on the app, and it'll be engineered automatically through AI. I heard it was pretty good. The end result was better than you would expect. One of the co-founders they were telling me is Mims from This Is Why I'm Hot. Any old schoolers out there, you know what I'm talking about. Try to play that song in the background. So yeah, let's see what else we find. This is from an app that that's about to roll out called Clippers. Now, Clippers is something really cool for barbers and for people in general, actually. So what it does is, if you're a barber, and I've heard this before, I've talked to my barber about this, a lot of shops take a lot of control of the barber themselves. And with this app, you can set up your own schedule. It's kind of like, think of like an Uber for barbers. And then also for people, you don't want to have to wait in a shop. A lot of barber shops get all messy. They're not like organized, and you have to like go in and wait. Not all of them have scheduled appointments. You can just set it up real quick on the app, get an appointment, know your exact time, or they'll go to you, and boom. It just gets you from point A to point B as quick and as easy as possible. And something that the guy brought up, Carlos, shout out to Carlos, one of the co-founders. Say you're traveling and you need to get a cut and you don't know where to go, you just get on the app and you'll find barbers in that area. So I thought that was really cool. That was really smart. And they have user profiles. So like, just like Uber, you can rate your barber. So when you get your haircut, you know you gotta go with people 4 and above. You never go below 4. So there you go. You know where to get a fresh cut at any time. Alright, so another company that stood out to me is this one called Streaming Bundles. So this is actually for anyone who wants to create a YouTube channel or a live stream of any sort on any platform. Just if you just want to become a creator and you need the equipment to create, what they do is they create these bundles for you that you can just find for a cheap price depending on what your wants are. And they'll ship all the equipment necessary for what you need. You can go on their site and check it out. Yeah, you just kind of get everything you need to get started right away through them just one time. You don't have to go through all that long-term research. I thought that was pretty interesting. This company is very, very useful for a space that's becoming very, very adopted and saturated right now, because there's so many people who want to create and create their own thing. So this is a great company to get you on your feet, and yeah. To make it to the studio.
Just for saying something. Now my passport's full, I'm out of pages.